Hi, Happy New Year. Today is the last day of the old 2023, all right? And blessed New Year to all in the room here and also those at home. Shall we pray as we begin the service? God, we thank you for freshness, Lord, that you give to us each day, because even as our outer man decay, Lord, our spirits are renewed every day, Lord, day by day, Lord, by your grace. And this constant stream of your grace upon our lives, let it be going on in strength each day, that we may look forward to not only just be alive, but to be alive before you, Lord. So we commit this service into your hands, ask you to bless us as we gather our hearts together to worship you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. We are going to look at the Bible study, but one of these things that when we come to the end of the year like this, we always think of what the days ahead will be like. And that time of reflection, we do it together every year. Okay, most of the years that we have done this, we have actually hold the watch night service in the sanctuary here. And for us, not only to just review, one of our traditions here is to write a love letter to Jesus, which are what people call the resolution type of thing. But we supply the paper and the pencils, so they can write whatever you feel there's something that you want to deal with the Lord. So do come tonight at 10:30. We will be having the service, the watch night service. Okay, we are continuing the third part of the heart of the king. When we think about praying the Lord's Prayer, it's such a wonderful thing to know that that kind of prayer is prayed. When it's prayed in unison by everybody, it has a certain good effect on us to see God as he should be. So let me continue again. We are continuing the third part of the heart of the king. He's verse is taken from, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you find rest for your souls." That gives us this clue that Jesus has a gentle and lowly heart. That's one of the most wonderful discoveries in our Christian life, to know that this Savior, this King, this Lord, this Judge, this Sanctifier is also somebody so different. Right? You will see the gentle and lowly heart is so different. As I said, the Matthew 11's verse is actually the only verse in the four Gospels that tell us what is the heart of Jesus. He opens up a very deep secret of his life, which other verses do not show. And we are amazed that he can be like that. And that part of the discovery should keep us in wonder, W-O-N-D-E-R, as we go along in our Christian life. Today, I hope to draw out more truths from Psalm 45. So let me read Psalm 45. "My heart overflows with a pleasing theme. I address my verses to the king. My tongue is like the pen of a ready scribe. You are most handsome of the sons of men. Grace is poured upon your lips. Therefore, God has blessed you forever. Gird your sword on your thigh, O mighty one, in your splendor and majesty. In your majesty, ride out victoriously for the cause of truth and meekness and righteousness. Let your right hand teach you awesome deeds. Your arrows are sharp in the heart of the king's enemies. The peoples fall under you. Your throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of your kingdom is the scepter of uprightness. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions." Let me just pause for a while. This word, this phrase, "God, your God," is a source of much discussion. Up to today, a lot of people cannot really fit through the how to understand this phrase, "God, your God." I'll come to that a little bit only later on. And so, "Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions. Your robes are all fragrant with myrrh and aloes and cassia. From ivory palaces, string instruments make you glad.
daughters of kings are coming among your ladies of honor. At your right hand stands the queen in gold of Ophir. Daughters of kings are among your ladies of honor. At your right hand stands the queen in Ophir. Hear, O daughter, and consider, and incline your ear. Forget your people and your father's house, and the king will desire your beauty. Since he is your lord, bow to him. The people of Tyre will seek your favor with gifts, the riches of the people. All glorious is the princess in her chamber, with robes interwoven with gold. In many colored robes, she is led to the king, with the virgin companions following behind her. With joy and gladness, they are led along as they enter the palace of the king. In place of your fathers shall be your sons, and you make them princes in all the earth. I will cause your name to be remembered in all generations. Therefore, nations will praise you forever and ever. Before I dive into that part of the psalm, I introduced this word to you before. The way to pronounce it is chiasm. Maybe it'll help you. Let's all say that together. Chiasm. One more time. So it's a literary device in which a sequence of ideas is presented and then repeated in reverse order. The result is a mirror effect as the ideas are reflected back in the passage. Each idea is connected to its reflection by a repeated word, often in a related form. Chiasm comes from the Greek letter chi, who looks like our letter X. You know, there is a group of Christians who spend a lot of time, like on the crusade like that, to say that we cannot use Xmas for our Christmas. Eh? You heard that? You read internet, a lot of arguments about this fact, Xmas. Eh? But actually, there's nothing wrong to use Xmas, provided you don't read it as X. You read it as chi. Chi is C-H-I, is one letter only. Oh, the C-H in Greek is pronounced as chi. So instead of saying Christ, they say chi. So the X there is really, I give you an example. See this Greek word? Chi. Pronounced as K-I. So it is not pronouncing as Xmas, but rather K-I-smas. Right? So all the hoo-ha in the internet is just a waste of time, isn't it? And all of us go and dive in, join sites, you know, yes, no, yes, no. I don't know why we should all get in. That's why I say in internet there are a lot of things can be like a red herring, thinking, wow, I will fall into sin if I, they say the X is to cancel out Christ. No, lah. Don't be so dramatic. An example, normal English, when it's used, it's like that, lah. If you plan to fail, you are planning to fail. Right? Okay. If you fail to plan, you are planning to fail. Sorry. Maybe my eyes should be adjusted. Oh, this is from John F. Kennedy. Do not ask what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country. See what he's trying to say. The first set of words or the first pattern, right, state something. Then the second one is the reverse of it. So over time, we call that it's like an inversion. Saying like the opposite. But they have connections. See? Fail, 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 fail there. Plan, planning. So these words tie them together. And in English, you don't, you see it like that. But in Bible, this is taken from John chapter 1, verse 29 to 34. They will put A, B, second line is B, C, then B1. B1 means it's connected to B there. And A1 means it's connected to A. Diabokiwa. Can you stay with me for a while? You get it through. So watch me. As that thing goes down like that, go down to the center, and from the center you go to the in. It's like half of an X. That's why it's called chiasm. What is the other letters mean? I don't know, but it's supposed to have a shape of an X. So you see from this Lamb of God, John's Gospel, chapter 1, 29 to 24, here is the Lamb of God. That's from verse 29. But look at A1. He is the Son of God, found in verse 34. B, which is taken from 1, 31. I came baptizing with water. Those letters there is baptismo. I came baptizing with water. Then look at B stroke. The one who sent me to baptize with water. So baptize and water are connected. And C is the center. C is the break point. C is the pivot. C is the, in our biblical studies, then we say C is the crux of the whole passage. What is, there are many words in the passage, but which is the main one? The joint there is the main one. That was put a very simple message to all of us. Not all Bible verses carry the same weight. I don't want to deal with other things. Some things get lesser and lesser and lesser and lesser. Until it, we spend a lot of time on the miniature until we won't have time to deal with the major thing. So if you take a passage like that, you know the author, all this is very hard to create chiasm. That's for sure. We have to borrow from people. Unless you spend all your life to create, study, and every book, every Bible chapter can be arranged and separated into one or two options. So sometimes it's not easy. So what is this passage trying to say? You go to verse 32. The main thing about all this, how to know who is the Savior, is the Spirit who comes down like a dove from the sky and remain on Him. So you know how to sort out. So true, many of these source for chiasm is not easy to find. You have to search very hard to find them. But just get the picture here, what I'm trying to get to. Because this chiasm is where your main thought is in the Bible. And you stay with it, you won't go wrong. This is the pivot that changes everything. There's a mirror there. And all these verses, the first half and the second half, are related. They always like to make it related so they can see a connection. Kai, right? Now watch this, huh? We're going to move now. Ching-tong. Okay, only Mac can do that. Okay, I've looked at this Kai for a very long time. And many times at a glance, I see it's like the tip of a spear. Isn't it? So someone who is creating chiasm, he will find that it, what he's trying to do? He's trying to get you to what is the real tip. An arrow or a spear needs a shaft to drive it. Of course, the feather is to guide it. But the shaft is to force. But the shaft is blunt. It cannot penetrate. So you have to have a tip of the spear that will really open up matters for you. So if you see this chiasm, that pivot point, the point where it turns, it's like a spear that will break up the verse for you and help you to understand better. Okay, so trust me, it's hard. So you go and search what people have done. It will always give you a better understanding of this Bible. Okay? So Psalm 45, you can do this. Eh? That's a prologue, A1. Because you're already looking at A2 lah. Correct? Or really A1 there, but A2 lah. Right? One is the verse for a king. The B1 and B2 talks about, B1 talks about the king's beauty and progress. C, the sevenfold glories of the king. So if you are reading chiasm or reading it chiasmically, that's a nice word, you know the heart of that whole passage in Psalm 45 is about the sevenfold glories of this king. And you can actually, you know, spend more time at that, dig in more there, and maybe in a certain sense, draw from that passage. Of course, every verse in the Bible, all scriptures are inspired by God. That goes without saying. But my proposal to you today is that you tweak a little bit of your understanding of the scriptures. And there are times you can't read it, you may need some help. But over time, it's a long progress. You pick up, oh, how they look at this. There are many, many variations of what is the typical chiasm. And verse 45, 10 to 15, the bride's beauty and procession. From verse 1 to verse 9 almost, everything is about the king. Then the turn change. The turn takes place. From 45:10 up to the 17, it's all about the bride. So it's these two things that come together and meet at this point. And you see how it takes these two parts to make that glory of God known. It takes the king's beauty and it takes the queen's beauty or the bride and produce this, drive it out. And you see it's centered on those passages in 45, 6 to 9. And then you begin to understand, oh, the king without the queen is not so glorious. The king is beautiful already. What? The bride or the queen is already beautiful. But when they converge together, you get a sevenfold glory of the king. And of course, why don't you say sevenfold glories of the king and queen? No, it is about the king mainly. The queen is just a supporting actor to bring out the sevenfold glories of the king. So, say something about the psalm. The psalm at the beginning of the title is called a love song. It is also called a messianic psalm because the descriptions found about this king in Psalm 45 can only be fulfilled by a man in the future who is great as a person, but having some divine qualities. That is the trick that make them all stumble. How to interpret this verse? And this verse is going to tell us Jesus Christ. So it is sometimes called messianic psalm. So it is also a bridal song where people are getting married. So it's a love song, a bridal song, a messianic song. We can, see how they depend on where you're coming from. It just sort of what suits you, it all gives you a better understanding of what Psalm 45 is like. So his first verse is, my heart overflows with a pleasing theme. I address my verses to the king. My tongue is like the pen of a ready scribe. The best way to summarize what he's trying to say, the poet is very enthusiastic. It's like, getting hold of breaking news, or you got news that war has started in another country, or somebody has won 1 billion ringgit or 1 billion US dollars for lottery or something. You yourself is going to meet the Pope or something like that. Does anyone dream about going to meet the Pope, having an audience with the Pope? You have a counseling session with Pastor Moses. But for the Pope, you call it audience. Fantastic. The pastor Tay was saying that was here the other week or what, a month ago. Just came back from Rome and he had an opportunity to have audience with the Pope. But you see, he got too busy, he didn't care about it. I say, when he shook hands with me, I say, you must be holier than me. What? You can see the Pope. I can't even see the Pope. And anyway, I have no dreams to see the Pope. That's why I'm not so sure I lost anything. Then come the second one, which is talking about the king's beauty. You're most handsome of men. That's what is found in verse 2. Can you imagine? He's starting to use superlatives. That means the highest, the greatest, the most handsome. All you men who try to be handsome, you rugi lah, you lost out long ago already. This guy is the most handsome. And that's our Jesus. Because grace is poured upon your lips. Therefore, God has blessed you forever. Gird your sword, verse 3, on your thigh, O mighty one, in splendor and majesty. In your majesty, ride out victoriously for the cause of truth and meekness. It speaks of an advancing king. So an advancing king is an advancing kingdom. This kingdom is the kingdom of God. It is won not by arrows and spears and swords and shields and so on, or with tanks and guns and bombs. It is won by a very simple thing: truth and meekness and righteousness. Again, very hard to bring this across, but really what I can summarize in this is that the kingdom of God is advanced by meekness. Can you catch that? If you read verse 4 in your Bible, in your majesty, ride out victoriously for the cause of truth and meekness and righteousness. In Hebrew, meekness and righteousness is a combined word, a conjoined word. So it's trying to say that meekness, well, it's still in the heart of what these three things are. Meekness drives the kingdom of God. So the kingdom of God, I say, it's not food and drink. We all know that. It's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. But it's also something that comes into us very unsuspectingly. It comes as meekness. Meekness is the engine that drives the kingdom. Or at least according to this Psalm 45, meekness becomes the main engine that drives the whole kingdom of God. So its whole progress, it's trying to say, is made by this kind of virtues. And then he goes on to show us these weapons are spiritual. Let your right hand teach you awesome deeds. Your arrows are sharp in the heart of the king's enemy. The peoples fall under you. So in the sense that we are won over, if we are enemies of God and this king is coming to advance, we are overcome not by power or by guns, but we are overpowered by his meekness and righteousness and truth. We need him because we are his enemies. He came not with these physical weapons, but his weapons were weapons of meekness and truth. And that can make us pause for a while. Wow! The gentle and lowly can be victorious people. The gentle and lowly can be overcomers. The gentle and lowly people are not being trampled. The gentle and lowly people, like Jesus said, his heart is gentle and lowly, can make us find great victories, great power to advance his kingdom. So now, two steps, then they become, I hope you remember the chiasm diagram of Psalm 45. We now come to the seven glories of the king. Sevenfold glories of the king. In verse 6, it tells us of his divine nature. Your throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of your kingdom is scepter of righteousness. This is the first thing. That because this word king forever and ever can be attached to this person, he must be a divine person. Nobody can be well, one of the qualities of being divine is that you live forever. And to assign this phrase forever and ever helps you to see that this king is actually a divine king. If you die halfway, no, you cannot be. If your throne, you die and your throne becomes empty, hell, you are not divine. And so to remain forever is a characteristic of a divine God. And then the second point, it is his upright rule found in verses 6 and 7. Your throne, O God, is forever and ever. And this upright rule follows to 7. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. So not only his throne is forever and ever, but what rules or what describe or what's the quality of his rule? There's uprightness, there's love for righteousness and hatred for wickedness. I think all of us love righteousness, but we don't have a hate for wickedness. That kind of quality can only be found in God. Because we may love righteousness, but when evil is present, we sometimes don't know how to hate it. We welcome it to our disadvantage. Then, therefore, God your God, the third point, his human superiority is higher than any other kind of human being. Therefore, God your God has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions. He has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions. The word beyond there simply means a higher quality of oil. You go and buy Middle Eastern oil. The same type of oil you buy, 50 ringgit a bottle. Another one, 75. They say this comes from the best olive orchard in Jordan. Then I ask, what is the best from Iran? You know, I look at it. I don't think it's the best. Oils of different grade, they say, oils for beauty, oils for medicinal value, oil for God. No, but in those Middle Eastern shops, they don't sell cooking oil. You don't waste your money on you don't buy so expensive oil to go and cook with them. We have many grades of oils for beauty, especially for beauty. And he's trying to say that this king, because he loved righteousness and hated wickedness, God had to use a very special quality of oil. It's just like saying buying a better perfume now. Why some bottle of perfume, how much? 200, some 2,000. Why is it like that? It is because it's a quality that is in it. So you have this king, this person is distinguished by this more expensive or higher quality of oil. I have always been very fascinated that how discerning God is. He doesn't just put everything together. Anointing oil. So to anoint David, they have to take a whole jug of oil and pour it over his head. It is very well known that King Charles, in the coronation service that was held this year, where he was coronated as a king, crowned as a king, the typical Anglican service will have a lot of songs about the whole idea of coronation found in the Psalms. We have taught here, right, that some of the Psalms are coronation Psalms, how a king is crowned. There's a whole service. So whenever a king or queen of England dies, they have to have a new king, and the Anglican Church has a fixed set of words or service for the crowning of the king. They will come to one part in the church itself, St. Paul's Cathedral, where the king will be, what's the word? He has a screen, a four-sided screen to hide him. Because there they will literally strip him down, I think, to his underwear and pour the oil over him. They don't like the anointing oil. That is a whole jug. And it's understood that. That's why they put up the screen for privacy. You can imagine if it's an expensive oil, whole jug going in, pouring out the oil. It must be very expensive. I don't think they go down to 7-Eleven and buy canola oil. I don't think they do that. And number four, he's a fragrant person. He smells nice with myrrh, aloes, and cassia. So this is a very descriptive picture. I hope you can imagine. He is righteous, his throne is forever, he's upright, he's anointed with a better quality of anointing oil that makes him very superior, above his companions, you know. And he smells nice also, isn't it? Then the fifth one, he is very rich. The words in verse 8 and all that, your robes are fragrant with myrrh and aloes and cassia from ivory palaces, string instrument back make you glad. Rich houses, perfume, smell, music, joy. It's a very much descriptive of a very rich, outwardly rich, wealthy kind of person. That's why number five, the fifth part of his glory is that his is a rich situation. You can basically say it's of a royal quality. Number six, which is his honored attendants, the servants that he had, daughters of kings are your ladies of honor. That simply means the people who serve him are not just servants, but they are of royal character. These are princesses and princes who come and serve this king. And surely, it also denotes that he is also of a higher quality than these servants. Number seven, the seventh glory of the king is his bride. At your right hand stands the queen in gold of Ophir, the climax of his ascending glory. That means with this bride at his side, it completes the glory of God. So God is great. Is greatly glorified. God has a great glory. God's glory is of multiple degrees. But the greatest degree of God's glory is exhibited when he has his bride by his side. That is the queen standing beside him. Pause for a moment and think. This King Jesus now, that's ruling in heaven, has a great throne. You read that in Revelation. As I say, if that, the psalm tells us, this king is only showing forth his greatest glory when his wife by his side. That's why 1 Corinthians 11 say, the glory of the man is his wife. Now, there are a lot of domestic interpretation on that. Let's not go that way now. Just remember, the glory of a man is his wife. So this king only exhibits the highest of his glory when his wife stands by his side. So, if you're married and you know, have a wife, you are most glorious when your wife stands upright together with you. That's what it seems to say. And then, this bride standing beside the king makes the king more glorious. Now we come to that part where it turns and talks about the bride's beauty and procession. The Bible says he is most handsome, in verse 2, I think. Verse 2 or 3. Then she is all glorious. Well, they are what you call a compatible couple, right? Handsome and she glorious. So just as Paul presented the bride of Christ to her bridegroom, to the church, to the bride, who is Jesus Christ, as God presented Eve to Adam, So the virgin companions, verse 14, presented the bride to the king. Now we see a shared throne. It's not just a throne. In the beginning, we see a throne with the king. But here now, we see a throne with the king sharing his throne with the bride. What can we take from this psalm? That meekness with truth and righteousness makes truth more truer, lah, and righteousness more righteous. Have you heard of Ajinomoto? No, you have not heard. You live in the caves for so long, you don't know what is Ajinomoto. Do you know what is MSG? Yes. What is MSG? Huh? Message. MSG is a long name, huh? Monosodium glutamate. What is the function of an MSG? Huh? To make you have high blood pressure, they say. Is it true? No, that's incidental. That's why some incidental things don't go there, lah. Go to the main thing. What is an MSG? It is just simply a food enhancer. Your chicken will taste like more real chicken. Your duck will taste like real duck, smell more ducky. And all these kind of things. Your beef will be beefier. Everything. Like I told you, I won't quote him. I was in a foreign country, eat the same brand of chicken. Here, like eating plastic. There, it's like real chicken. So, you know, I have always said, why you both call chicken? One is less of a chicken, one is real, real chicken. Meekness is like a food enhancer. That's the word you use. It enhances everything around it. That's why all these seven glories of God, the sevenfold glories of God, are enhanced when you employ or use meekness to make it more glorious. Make truth truer. Make righteousness more righteous. Some of you may know that I had cataract operation. So the first few days or first few months after the cataract operation, the sky is bluer. The grass is greener. The light, the bright is brighter. Everything looks more sharp, it's sharper in focus. Now no more, yeah? It's very hard to understand what the power of meekness is. It just enhances everything. So what is a righteous man without meekness? Isn't it? A righteous man with meekness makes him look more righteous. What is glory? If you have no weakness in there, but when you put in weakness in it, then it becomes a higher glory. And all the things we can talk about in the fruit of the Spirit, in the character of God, in our own character development, they become much more enhanced by meekness. And is this meekness, so really when you look at it, it's not new Bible studies, you know. It's the same old truth. Live it out and be meek. Whatever you have learned will be enhanced in your life. I give you, suppose that's supposed to be like, oh, we should be holy. We study 10 more chapters from the tabernacle of David and Moses. I read more and more. Hey, please, I don't mean to demean reading all this good literature. But if you are thinking that gaining more information will make you more righteous, it won't. If you learn how to meek, even whatever you have learned about meekness or the Bible study, you are able to enhance this quality in your life. And that is what I think these three times I'm here, is my burden to pass to you that we are all better people. You don't need, you already know, okay, say whatever that we talk about in the Galatians, fruit of the Spirit. You don't need a fresh course. Or maybe you need a reminder, that's all. But there's nothing new now, basically. How it gets rooted into our life, how it becomes more enhanced in our life, is learning to be meek. Because Jesus said, come learn of me. I'm of a gentle and lowly heart. I'm meek. My heart is meek. As we go and learn with him, we will realize that it is not anything new, but things are enhanced in our life. And basically, that's what all it takes in our life. So when we combine this, some people will say it is love. I agree. But sometimes love, there are many definitions of love. And sometimes love is only an attitude. But this quality of meekness runs through the centuries. And we don't, because it is not appreciated in the wider society, people put down that value of that quality. People think it is just incidental to our Christian life. People think that, you know, optional. If we have it, good. If we don't have it, but I'm trying to present before you that it is far more essential, far more necessary ingredient to make our way in advancing the kingdom of God. I think this is something that we sometimes treat it and put it on the wayside and becomes like, you know, a side issue. We've got the Americans now call it. It becomes a sidebar issue. So if you want to know what's a sidebar, go and read up properly. But please don't interpret as a bar on the side of the church. The last one, when we take out this psalm, right? Really, what is that Hebrew word I was laboring to point out to you is, it's a meek righteousness. Meekness righteousness, sorry. Right? First, it makes other qualities more enhanced, and then it is a way to advance the kingdom of advancing force of the kingdom with this twin quality of meekness and righteousness. And with that, it not only enhances, it causes the kingdom of God to progress. I do not think that we can actually be perfect in this. That's something we all have to recognize. But recognize that we are all growing in this quality of meekness combined with righteousness. To stand in awe, Lord. We know what we don't know, Lord. That you are certainly beyond our understanding. You're certainly higher than everything that we know of on this earth, Lord. God, you are our God, and that's all we know. When we say we stand in awe, we are trying to pray prayers that we don't know how to pray, Lord. But hear our heart today. We aspire to be a worshipper of God. We want to be the kind of worshipper that's not only made righteous by Jesus Christ, but carry with it a quality of meekness that enhances our life, that advances the kingdom of God. These are prayers that we know is only the tip of an iceberg of a big lump of things that you have placed in our hearts, Lord. But we thank you each day as you draw out those tiny, tiny things from our heart related to your kingdom. We first want to tell you, we thank you for even the small amount of light. We have learned, Lord, as each light we receive, we thank you for the light. More light will come, Lord. You are leading us finally to live in the fullness of the light of Jesus Christ, who say he is the light of the world. And here, with whatever little light that we have of your scriptures, may we understand something of your own heart. Just as being gentle and lowly makes you understand everybody in this room, Lord. We, on turn, look up to you and say, then help us to understand you. Amen. It's a huge prayer. It's almost like an impossible prayer. Your heart is so deep. Your heart is so profound. But surely we know what is it like and feel what is it like to be understood. You also want to be understood. You prayed the psalmist say of this of you, all this you do, I remain quiet. You think I'm like you. It's so profound, Lord. Many times you are quiet. We just assume you are like us, Lord. But we are so lousy. We are so weak. We are so unlike you. How dare, Lord, we think you can be like us, Lord. But this morning, we hope that you hear what we cannot pray, Lord. That you are indeed a glorious God. May that reality seep into our heart more and more. May we find the reality more real than ever before. The glory more glorious than ever before. And this may be our lifelong prayer, we know. But certainly, it's a good time. Anytime is a good time to pray this prayer. Help us to know you and understand you. The service is over. God bless you. Have a blessed new year. Have a great time with your family, those who are coming back. Upstairs, there will be coffee fellowship. Tonight at 10:30, we are meeting again for the watch night service. The Lord bless you. The Australians say, bless you out of your socks.